this easy.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming today. This is a Marshall County Historical Society event. I don't know if you know, but the society manages the Cockayne Farmstead. Thank you also for helping us keep you all safe. So we try to socially distance, we're trying to wear our masks so that everybody is safe at this outdoor event. We are braving, usually this is our third year for Hungry for History. Usually we have our events in the back under that tree you'll see in back of the house where there's shade there, but there's not enough shade for this many people. So we're going to brave the traffic today so that we can have you all safe. Another thing that I wanted to say is that there are flyers on the table. If you haven't picked them up, there are flyers about our remaining Hungry for History events this year. I was telling somebody that our first Hungry for History event, we had two people. By the end of that year, we were averaging 25. Last year, that increased to about 45 an event. We have some exciting events this year. They're all scrunched together because we had to cancel. We were supposed to have Slim's event in late May. So it's a little bit hotter now than it was then. We do have the flyers about our events, and also we will have a walking tour through Mount Rose Cemetery in September. If you would like to receive notification of our events, we have an email sheet that you can sign up and we will let you know what's going on. And especially, we are weather dependent. So if it rains, we've got a problem. So we might cancel at the last minute, and if we had your email address, we would be able to let you know about that. Our future goal is to have a barn-like outbuilding on the South Lawn where we can have these type of events and we don't have to worry so much about weather. Our guest today really needs, was I supposed to tell them anything else, Kara? This is Kara Gordon, our AmeriCorps service member. She's the one that's been putting much of this together, and Kara is going to begin working for us full-time when her AmeriCorps service ends in late August. So she's going to be continuing our service here at Cockade, and we're very proud of that. So, I don't think I have to do very much to introduce Slim. You all know him. But I was talking to one of his classmates when he was in the eighth grade at Mount Hope School. There were only four members in his class. Now, you often wonder, how does somebody decide what they're going to do during the path of their life? What are they going to do? But Slim seemed to know at that early age. And not only that, but he changed his name so that he started signing his homework, not Richard Hartley, his given name, but Slim Lehart. So he knew that early what he was going to do. We're very proud to have him today. We're very proud to have this many people here. We do have drinks. There's water, iced tea, pop. And so just need to hold up your hand and we'll try to get you something. So let's turn this over to Slim Lehart, the Wheeling Cat.
You sure didn't think I was going to stand up, did you? Hello, everybody. How's everybody doing? Hi, Aaron. Anyway, it's good to be here. Almost the afternoon. I like the traffic, but anyway, it's good to be here. It's good to have been asked to be here because I don't get very many invites anymore. I mean, maybe from the bank or something. But anyway, it's good to see all you folks. And I'll tell you a little bit about my life. I won't tell you all of it because it's not quite over yet. So I can't tell everything. But anyway, I was born in Marshall County, out along Big Wheeling Creek, June the 25th, 1935. I just had a birthday a week or two ago. So, anyway, thank you. So I'm 85, and I do have some back problems. That's why I get around kind of easy. But anyway, I was born there on a farm, 175 acres, where I grew up. Done chores on the farm, of course, and learned at that time that I didn't want to be a farmer because I didn't think that was the life for me. So when I got old enough, I did get a job in Wheeling with W.A. Wilson and the glass people. And I worked there for a while, and I worked another couple jobs around there, and went from one to the other. Then I went back home and helped my brother-in-law in the timber business. We cut white oak timber for stave mills. And the staves eventually went to the Glenmore Distillery in Kentucky, making barrels for that stuff that I drink. But anyway, I helped manufacture that. So anyway, as time went on, the Korean War came about, and of course I joined the Navy. The reason, because all my friends out in the country was being drafted. So I thought, well, I needed to go too. So that's what I done. But I got a little bit ahead of myself there. My family all played music. My dad played the fiddle, my mother the piano. My brothers and sisters all played guitars, mandolins. And when I was 10 years old, I was playing a tenor banjo with my thumb. Didn't have a pick, I just used my thumb. I'd be recording to the square dance tunes that my dad would play, like Coming Around the Mountain and Chinese Breakdown, and them sort of songs. So anyway, my brother, oldest brother, He had a good job, so he started buying musical instruments and equipment. He bought an amplifier, PA system, one mic, and the funny part about that was we didn't have electricity. So I would have to go someplace and take it someplace to a neighbor that had electric so I could try it out and use it. Anyway, as time went on, as I said before, I did join the Navy, and I was 17 years old. My dad had to sign for me to get in. I'll never forget, we was walking down the sidewalk up to the big post office in Wheeling, where the recruiter was, and in the morning, and my dad all at once stopped. And I turned around, and I said, what's the matter? He said, well, I can sign to get you in, but I can't sign to get you out. Is that what you want to do? And I said, yeah. So when I got to boot camp, I thought, what kind of mistake did I make? So it was kind of tough for me. Back in them days, we had to wash our clothes with a Kai brush and all that stuff. And after we got out of boot camp, while I was in boot camp, you never wore leggings and put the jeans around tight. So I earned a name there as Pencil Pants. That's what they called me, Pencil Pants. Looked like two pencils going down there. But anyway, I got out of boot camp and was assigned to an aircraft carrier. And I really joined hoping I would learn diesel mechanic. So anyway, when I was getting all signed to division and so on, you get down this line and the officer says, "What division you want in?" I said, "Engineering." He said, "What department?" I said, "I want to be in the E division, which is engineman." He said, "That's good. You're in B division, which is boilers." So I spent 3 years down as far as down in the ship you can get, being a boiler tender. And boy, if you think it's hot here today, you ought to have been down in that fire room in Cuba. But anyway, when I look back on it, it was really good for me. It taught me how to be responsible and take care of myself. The whole Navy thing was a good thing for me. I got out of the Navy and I had got married, and I'd lived in Wind Ridge, Pennsylvania at the time. And I lived there for quite a while. Then I moved to Cameron, West Virginia, where I worked as a mechanic in a Chevrolet Pontiac garage. And I worked there for some time. Then I went back to what we call Jacktown, Wind Ridge, Pennsylvania. And I worked in a general garage there. And at that time, my brother-in-law, my wife's brother, who lived in Columbia, Tennessee, had got a golf service station, and he called me and asked me to come and run it. So I did that, moved the family to Columbia, Tennessee. I was there a couple of years, and then I moved back to Wheeling, really. And anyway, I went to work with Nello Tier Company, which was a road builder, built a road through Benwood and so on. And I was there for quite a few years. And I was a parts expediter. But when somebody didn't show up, if it was a dozer operator, a push cat, or whatever, they'd take me out of the shop there and I'd have to do that job. So anyway, I got a lot of experience of things I didn't want to do. So all this time, I was still playing music all the time. I played when I was in Tennessee in the service station. On a Saturday, I had a lot of Southern Bell telephone trucks to take care of, wash them and so on. So I would go downtown to the square and I'd drive around, and there was a lot of people sitting on the wall there, and I'd ask them, do you want to work? So you'd get a couple of guys that said, "Yeah, we'll do that." So they'd come and wash trucks and so on, and I'd also offer them, I would buy their lunch. So that was a good thing too. So for their lunch, I'd get a big RC and a moon pie for them. So anyway, I was very generous. But anyway, as time went on, I moved back to Wheeling. I was playing music all the time, even in the service station. It was real busy, and I would sometimes just stop everything. We'd go back in the back room and play music. And the customers just stand around and listen to you. We'd play maybe for 10 or 15 minutes, and they would all go back to work. Everything was fine. So anyway, I moved to Ohio. I had a golf service station there, which was really one of the worst experiences I had in business. I finally went down the tubes there, and I went downtown. I borrowed a front-end alignment machine and went to work taking care of B.F. Goodrich, all their tire store. Anybody need alignment or so on that send them to me. So I was doing that, and I got a phone call from the golf distributor in Columbia, Tennessee, and he wanted to know if I could come there and help open up a tire battery and accessory warehouse. He had two other partners, so we had five counties together. So naturally, I really enjoyed that phone call because I really needed to get something steady, you know. So back to Tennessee I went. That time I stayed about 5 years, and I traveled five counties in Middle Tennessee. I bought a big, like a moving van truck, built shelves in it and so on. And I just go down the road, stopping at all the stores and service stations and peddling my goods. You know, I was a real peddler back then. So anyway, as time went on, we moved back to Wheeling. And I got so poor, I stayed there. I couldn't leave. That's why I stayed here all the time. But anyway, that's when I went to work for Nello Tier and done all those jobs. And I actually drove tractor and trailer and hauled wide loads and so on to, they was out of Durham, North Carolina. So I would take the equipment to Durham and back this way. And they had several jobs like at Breezewood, Pennsylvania and Charlottesville, Virginia. And so I done a lot of running around there to those places. So anyway, I always wanted to be on the Jamboree. So I got to know Bob Finnegan. He was at the time with WWVA. And there was a guy, Lee Sutton, was in charge of the Jamboree. Well, I don't think me and Lee hit it off real good, but me and Bob did. So I come in one night to the Jamboree, and anyway, Bob Finnegan was running the Jamboree that night. Lee Sutton was off, so Bob put me on. So I went on that night and done, I guess, a good enough job. So they kind of hooked me up as a guest artist. That was in 1995. So I was a guest artist until 1970, and that's when I became a regular cast of the new name, Jamboree USA. And by the way, I was the first guy to sign up under that new name, Jamboree USA. That's one of my points that I make. And also, the Jamboree in the Hills came about. I was on the Jamboree in the Hills the first time in 1977. The director of the Jamboree said, he met with me at the Cork and Bottle, of course, and he said, this Jamboree in the Hills, he said, do you think you could attract one person? I said, I think I could. He said, well, I'm going to put you on it, and the price, I believe, then was $25 to get into Jamboree in the Hills. And so that's what they paid me to be there. I still have the check because I didn't think people would believe that I was over there. It come to $22 and something after the dues was out. So anyway, the very next year, I was the opening act in 1978. And that was really an accident. I wasn't supposed to be the opening act, but I was going to be on second. But the guy who was supposed to open it up, he didn't show up. So I had my bus, and I had a lot of people on my bus, probably half a dozen or so. It came down from Michigan. That's where my wife's sister lived, and they all came down to Jamboree in the Hills. So I had them on my bus. And I'm going out there. I don't know, the guy didn't show up. So they all had their money out and everything to pay. And when I got in sight, they seen my bus coming. They started motioning me on through, you know. So I just went right on through, and that's what it was about. It was about to start, and they didn't have an opening act. So I went right on down, and that was my second time on the Jamboree in the hills. I was there the third time, and, you know, it was all right maybe, but it wasn't really my kind of thing. When I drink, I like to be indoors, you know, not in the sun. And them guys out there in 95 degree heat, walking around chugging out of a bottle, straight out of the bottle. And I thought, this is no place for me. I need to get out of this place. So I never went back until 2008. I did go back and done a side stage, which was not good. But my band wanted to be on Jamboree in the Hills. So if it hadn't been for that, I wouldn't have went. And I wouldn't have stayed after I got there either. But anyway, that's things that happen. I also played the Jamboree at the prison down here. I was in Wheeling. It was a sporting goods store there. I forget the name of it, but it was like Saturday, Christmas time. They had drinks and food there, and I'm there, you know, drinking and eating their food and seeing a lot of people. And I got a phone call. They called there for me. And it was a Jamboree director. Wanted to know if I could be on the Jamboree that night at the prison. I said, hold on a minute. They had a nice looking young lady working there. And I went to her and I said, would you go with me to the Jamboree in the prison tonight? She said, yes. Yeah. So I went back and said, yeah, I'll be there. So I had a state policeman. He got to be a friend. He was a lead guitar player. And anyway, I called him and asked him if him and his wife would come to Jamboree at the prison. He said, yeah. So we get down, and I just get there in time to go on. And somebody I know knew Art McKenzie. He was a warden at the time. And anyway, I just got there in time to go on. So I went on. When I get done, my guest was nowhere to be found. I asked one of the guards, where's my guest? He said, they're back out in the wheelhouse. That they wasn't dressed proper to be here. I said, where's the warden? He said, he's somewhere. I said, get him. I want to talk to him. So Art come, but anyway, that's in the days when the hot pants and boots and stuff was. He said, they wasn't dressed to be in the prison, I guess. So anyway, that's some of the experiences I've had. And one time I had a job up in New York, Watkins Glen, New York. So I'm up there, and I have three band members with me. And so we got the job done. Pappy's Playground was the name of it. It was like Watkins Glen. So we get the show done, and we go to the motel. And the guy pays me cash, so I put that in my briefcase and have it in the trunk of my car. I was driving a car that was a Hunley Ford car, because I was working for Hunley Ford at the time, selling cars. And I'm in the motel, and the next morning I get up. I'm in a room by myself, and the other guys are, a couple of them together, I don't know how it was. But anyway, I'm waiting on them to come down for breakfast. I see this paddy wagon going back and forth. I could see it right out there going back and forth. But I didn't think too much about it. So the guys came. We had our breakfast, started to leave. I had one of them in my car, and the other two was in another vehicle. And I pulled out, and I noticed that paddy wagon pulled out right behind me. So I needed gasoline, so I just pulled up the street and pulled over to the gas station. And he pulled right in behind me. So he got out. I mean, we had to get out, put our hands on the roof and frisk us and everything. And so he took my keys and he said, I don't know if he said follow me or they towed. I believe they towed it to the, it was a sheriff really. So they towed me to the sheriff's office out kind of out on the side of town. And so anyway, they said, the sheriff came out and pointed at the desk. There was a phone there. He says, pick up that phone. Well, I picked it up. I didn't know who was going to be on the other end. I knew it wasn't J. Edgar Hoover because he'd already passed away. But I didn't know who it might be. So I picked it up. And I said, hello. The guy says, Slim, what are you doing up there? I said, who is this? And here's the state policeman that plays guitar. You know. But anyway, I had a license plate that had been stolen, I guess, that they kept the same numbers every year, I think. And anyway, this sheriff, he thought he had a big time criminal, you know. So he detained me probably for a couple of hours or so. And when he finally let me go, he just came out, threw the keys to me, says, you can go now. Not very friendly, you know. He was disappointed he didn't catch that big convict, I guess. So anyway, I've had a lot of experiences that way, getting the wrong place at the wrong time, and people think they know you and they don't know you. But I met a lot of nice people too in my travels, because I traveled for about 20 years with my bus and the band, and was in Canada quite a bit, was all over the eastern U.S. really, and everything went good. I have a lot more I could tell you, but some of it I can't tell you. And I think you know the heading of my story. If that old guitar could talk, I'd have to burn it. That's a fact. I'm getting off of my... I'm getting off of my notes here. Oh yeah, I got to tell you about this one. I got to know Ernest Tubbs' manager when I lived in Columbia, Tennessee, because Ernest Tubb was opening another record shop in Columbia, Tennessee. So I got to know the guy who was opening the store, and it's going to have a show out at the fairgrounds. And so anyway, he had borrowed chairs from a church, I guess it was, and he needed to get them out to the fairground, and I had a van, so I told him I could take the chairs out. So I took him out, and he was having a show, and it was the Wilburn Brothers, Loretta Lynn, and there was a guy that I just met that I'd never heard of. His name was Ray Griff. He was a Canadian, good singer, good entertainer, and that's where I met Loretta Lynn the first time. And anyway, after that, this manager would put me on the Ernest Tubb Record Shop show on Saturday nights up in Nashville, right after the Opry. And anyway, I could get on there anytime. I'd just call him and he'd put me on, you know. So this one particular time, I was there and I was to go on. This was 1966, and Charlie Louvin of the Louvin Brothers was hosting the show that night, and in come Johnny Cash. He had just come from the hospital, and anyway, Charlie Louvin come to me and said, Slim, would it be all right to put Johnny on first, because I don't think he'll make it to the last. I argued with him, but no, I didn't. I said, sure, go ahead, you know. And So Johnny went on. He didn't have his guitar or anything. He'd just come from the hospital. So he borrowed my guitar, and he done his thing. The record shop was packed full. I don't know if any of you have been to the Emerson Tub Record Shop in Nashville. But anyway, it's a small record shop, narrow and long. So anyway, he done his thing. And I mean, the people, you know, really was nice to him. Give him a big applause. And when he done one of the songs, I forget which one it was. It might have been the Orange Blossom Safe he sang. And somebody gave him the two harmonicas. He always played the harmonicas. Well, when he done that, he laid this guitar down, and he was stepping wildly, you know. And the lead guitar player, if he hadn't grabbed my guitar, he would have stepped on it. So anyway, he was over, and they introduced me. I got a nice reception. After I sang my song, I got about the same amount of applause as he did. And I thought, look out, Wheeling, here I come. I just followed the biggest guy in country music, so don't mess with me, you know. So that gave me a lot of confidence that particular time. So they closed the record shop. People were still out on the sidewalk, and I don't know how people knew that I was there, but boy, a lot of people came. They was out in the street, sidewalk covered. So we went back in Ernest's office and stayed there probably 20 minutes or so, waiting on the crowd to leave. And at the time, Johnny was really out of it. He was sitting, and he would stretch and do all kinds of stuff, and he'd hit himself in the head like that, and he'd stretch and stick his legs out. He was a mess, you know. But anyway, when we went back out, there they was. The street was full, sidewalk full. He signed autographs and handed it to me, and I'm signing autographs. And I thought, can't get any better than this. Midnight in Nashville on Broadway, signing autographs with Johnny Cash. So, like I say, it really did boost my morale or whatever it was, enthusiasm. So, anyway, as time went on, Johnny died, you know. And I thought people would probably get that autograph out and say, I got Johnny Cash's autograph. But wonder who in the hell that Slim Lehart guy is. And they still don't know. Another time, well, a couple of times, I went to Canada, and I crossed the first time up at the Peace Bridge up at Buffalo. And anyway, at that time, the Canadians really didn't care about me being there. You know, I'm taking work from their musicians. So I had to unload all the equipment off the bus, get all the serial numbers off of it, and they'd estimate what it was worth, and I'd have to pay 10% of it, and I'd have to take a cab into town to get Canadian money. They wouldn't even take my money. So that wasn't very good. It wasn't very nice, but I had to do it. When I come back, I have to unload it, they check the serial numbers and everything, and we'll send you your check in a couple of weeks. You know. Then I started going, started doing a job at Sault Ste. Marie over a little farther west, north of Detroit. And I went there the first time, and I must have got to the border. It must have been nighttime. And they'd come on the bus. And I remember me being on the bus and me looking out. They were sitting out there, the band, and they looked like refugees. And I thought, man, we're never going to get through the border. But we did. And they went through the bus, and they'd take suitcases, and they'd just dump them out on the bed, and they just tore the thing up, you know. So anyway, I went on in and played at the place, the Airways Motor Hotel, which was really a nice place. So everything went well there, and I booked back. But when I was there the first time, I met a guy and his daughter. They both worked at the border. So what I would do when I was going there, I'd call him and say, when are you working? So when he's working, I could get right on through. So that made it pretty nice, because that was one of the nicest places that I probably ever played. And it would hold, I think, around 700 people. It kept opening up doors back. There was three rooms. And they could just keep opening up as long as you had the crowd. There would be like, in the wintertime when I was there, it would be like 90 snowmobiles in the parking lot. You know, just that's how they travel. And like in the daytime, there was no business there, and there was snow on the ground. I'd get in my bus and I'd do donuts with my bus. So anyway, I've had a good time. I've played a lot of places, and some of them I remember. Let me look at my notes here and see if there's anything I need. Oh, yeah. Also, in 1970, that's when I met Barbara, and in 1979, we got married. And that's the best part of my life. From then until January 2019, when I lost her. But she sang with me. We was together all the time. I couldn't have done any better, and I miss her every day, every minute of the day, yet today. And I suppose I will to the day I die. But she died from dementia. I took care of her for about 4 years. Had to put her in a rest home for 6 months, and then she passed. So anyway, when we was up in Sault Ste. Marie, Barbara could sing, but I could never get her to sing. So when we was up there, she finally told me she would sing with me on Saturday night. She said, that way, if they don't like me, we're going home anyway. So anyway, she sang with me, and from then on, I had a singing partner, and she did a good job of it. So anyway, oh yeah, some of you probably remember I served one term here as a Marshall County Commissioner, and I always said the reason you serve one term, honest people only serve one term. So anyway, is my friend here? I know I got a couple of friends here, but the one that I know, I appreciate every one of you. This lady. Shirley, are you here? Is that you? Is that you, Sally? Holy mackerel. I didn't know who you was, but Sally is a longtime friend of mine, 50 years plus. And when she found out, I dialed her number because I was deleting the ones that had passed away and so on. And her number came up, and so I punched it and she answered. And it was unbelievable. And so anyway, I had told her that I'd had back surgery and so on. And so she wanted to come and help me. And anyway, boy, my feet are getting numb sitting on this stool. Anyway, she wanted to come and help me, and She was going to fly in, and that's when the virus gained on us. So she stopped that. Her daughter lived out. She lived in Olympia, Washington, and her daughter lived close to her. So once she called me, she says, "Get ready, really." She said, "Her daughter's going to drive me." So they did. 3 days took them to get here. She drove 3,000 miles. I don't know about my legs sitting on this stool. But anyway, it's good to have you here, Sally, and your mom, Shirley. I didn't recognize you with your mask on. I see you now. Let's give her a big hand. She came a long ways. Yep. She's a good, long-time friend, really. I mean, I couldn't believe. She was a good friend of my wife, Barbara. They had horses together and all that stuff, so they knew each other way back there. But anyway, I'm glad you got to come, Shirley and Sally. I don't know if there's anything else I want to tell you or not. A few things I've done that probably people don't know. I know there's things I've done that people don't know. You ain't gonna know either. Anyway. I was always involved in a lot of community service, and I performed a lot of benefits for people in need. Maybe their house burnt, or maybe an illness or whatever, and I would always be there to try to get a little money to help them out. So anyway, I was, over the years I've served on the Marshall County Planning Commission, was chairman of the board of the Marshall County Senior Center. I served on the Community Projects Committee, was president of that group for 4 years, and I already told you I entertained at the prison, and I played many bus tours in the Wheeling area. I was founder of the Slim Lehart Picnic, which went on for 24 years. I also created several events in Viola, which included the Midnight Jamboree, New Year's Eve in July, the canoe races, and the turtle races. I'm also a 32nd degree Mason, a member of the Scottish Rite and the Osiris Shrine. I'm also a member of the Legion of Honor. I also belong to the American Legion, and I was featured in the Wheeling magazine a few years ago. Comes out there. And I need a secretary. Probably need more than a secretary. Do what? Yeah, I'm going to try that. How long has it been? Huh? Is that too long? Okay. I forgot I was supposed to play the guitar a little bit. Over 6 feet tall without wearing a hat. Ain't nothing short about the Wheeling cat. Big Cadillac and his bankroll fat. Everybody loves a Wheeling cat. Well, a wheeling cat, he's a sight to see. He played in wheeling at the Jamboree. Great big star guitar man. Number one singer all over the land. Hear women screaming, I want that. You know they're talking about the wheeling cat. Everywhere he goes, he gets a welcome mat. There ain't no slack in a wheeling cat.
Meow.
When the president came to our town one day, nobody came to hear what he had to say. At the auditorium, a big crowd sat. Everybody turned out to see the wheeling cat. Yeah, the folks all came from far and near to see the tall, dark balladeer. Off the stage, he's quite mild. When he sings, man, he drives them wild. Wrecked his Cadillac and said, how about that? Said, send me two more and build a wheeling cat. Yeah, the folks all came from far and near to see the tall, dark balladeer. Off the stage, he's quite mild. When he sings, man, he drives them wild. You know, if I had my way about this and that, I'd kind of like to be the wheeling cat. But I don't know, because I know it's rough. Poor Slim's going to make it. He's got to be tough. You got to walk the line besides all that. I heard they don't need another wheeling cat. Larry, would you come here a minute? Help me, please. I need that piece of paper. Yeah. Thank you very much. This is Larry Hennessy. He's another old country singer. I hadn't seen him in years till today. Good guy. Anyway, I want to read you my poem. Because it looks like there's a lot of senior citizens here. So I'm not counting you, Jim and Ellen. Anyway, that lady there, I don't know if I ought to blame this on you because I wasn't sticking to my script. Anyway, she helped me put this little whatever it is together to try to keep me on track so I didn't tell the end of the story at the first and so on. But that's Ellen. Let's give Ellen a hand for helping me out there. Thank you, Ellen. So I want to do this poem. It's for senior citizens. Maybe some of you have heard me do it before, but it goes, a row of bottles on my shelf cause me to analyze myself. One yellow pill I have to pop goes to my heart so it won't stop. A little white one I take goes to my hands so they won't shake. The blue ones that I use a lot tell me I'm happy when I'm not. The purple pill goes to my brain and tells me that I have no pain. The capsules tell me not to wheeze or cough or choke or even sneeze. The red ones, smallest of them all, go to my blood so I won't fall. The orange ones, very big and bright, prevent my leg cramps in the night. Such an array of brilliant pills helps to cure all my ills. But what I'd really like to know is what tells each one where to go. That's my favorite poem. I'm going to sing a couple more songs, and they're special to me. They might not mean anything to you, but they do to me, and I'm going to sing them whether you like it or not. Barb and I, we had these two songs. I sang them about every job I'd done, and she knew that I was singing to her. I didn't have to tell her. She knew both songs. So, if I can get through them. Forever and always, my love will be true. I'd wait for a lifetime if you ask me to. You make me so happy, then leave me so blue. But I'd wait forever and always for you. I'd pray each night that God above will make my dream come true. To hear my prayer and make you care. My life I'd offer you, for riches won't buy you a heart true as gold, forever and always, to have and to hold. Forever and always, to have and to hold. Thank you very much. I'm going to do this one song now, and it'll be my last one, at least for today. I hope I can. My voice is getting kind of somewhere else. This song was our song, and this song almost could have been written for me, because I've experienced a lot of the parts of this song. I have sailed the peaceful waters of the ocean deep and blue. I've held my breath and watched the western sunset's golden view. I've flown above the mountain peaks and valleys wide and green. But you're the nearest thing to heaven that I've seen. You're the nearest thing to heaven. Yes, you are. I have searched for happiness so long and far. But my search for love was through the day that I found you. And you're the nearest thing to heaven, darling, you. I'll confess that I've been tempted by alluring magic charm, when a smile splashed my way and stood before two open arms. I turned and walked away because I love you like I do. And you're the nearest thing to heaven, darling, you. You're the nearest thing to heaven. Yes, you are. I have searched for happiness so long and far, but my search for love was through the day that I found you. And you're the nearest thing to heaven, darling, you. I have watched the silver raindrops fall to earth to cool the day. Watched the rain go at twilight when the clouds have blown away. I love the pretty flowers that they cannot buy the worth, because you're the nearest thing to heaven on this earth. You're the nearest thing to heaven. Yes, you are. I have searched for happiness so long and far, but my search for love was through the day that I found you. And you're the nearest thing to heaven, darling, you. And you're the nearest thing to heaven, darling, you. Thank you very much. One more little note on that. I sang that song at her funeral, and I didn't know if I could get it done, but I got it done. Thank you very much, everybody. Thanks for coming. Thanks for staying.
Thank you, Slim. We really appreciate it. We really appreciate it. It's so hot, and we've got so many people out here. It's just really wonderful. Thank you for those that are watching on YouTube or on our Facebook page as well, because this is on those mediums. Thank you for coming today. Next week, hopefully it won't be this warm, but Kara is going to, our theme this year was World War II. We've had to cancel a couple of really nice events, and so probably we'll be doing them next year. But next week, during World War II, everybody sacrificed. There was a lot of, things that we couldn't buy. Everything was rationed, and we had to use what we had. And so Kara next week is going to show us how to change a man's suit into a woman's suit. And I will tell you, she's been struggling with this week. She's an excellent seamstress, but she's been struggling. So hopefully you can come and be with us next week. Hopefully it won't be so hot. Thank you.